So last night we had a conversation about the role of individuals in forging peace and in sustaining peace. And of course, peace is personal, and so is war. And as you know, Colombia has endured a 50-year, a half-century civil war, and just recently was able to reach a peace agreement with the FARC. Not easily done. I mean, in a civil war, as I say, war is personal. Every family has had an experience. Every family has had a family member kidnapped, a family member killed. Under those circumstances, it's very, very, you know, nothing could be harder than forging a peace. But because with extraordinary skill, and I should say some empathy, President Santos's administration was able to end that 50-year war. And the FARC is demobilizing, is returning to normalcy. And I, you know, quite rightly, President Santos was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for achieving this peace. The man I'm going to introduce to you is going to be much better at telling this story because he lived it. But he also had a big role in creating this peace. So while President Santos rightly got the Nobel Prize, it would be a mistake to underestimate the role that Ambassador Pinzón played when he was Minister of Defense and when he was Chief of Staff to the President. In both instances, his highest priority was to bring the civil war to the end, to an end, and find a peace agreement with the FARC. Not only did he lay the groundwork for peace in those past roles, he is now the Colombian ambassador to the United States, and his task now is to gain the support of the U.S. government for the implementation of the peace plan. So as we move from Plan Colombia to Peace Colombia, it is his job to gain that support for implementation. And of course, we all stand with him. So please join me in welcoming Ambassador Pinzón.
Buenos dias. Good morning, all. Jane, thank you so much. What a kind introduction. You're very generous for introducing me and to spread the word about Colombia. That's nice from you. What a great opportunity to be in this 2017 Global Philanthropy Forum. And by the way, allow me to congratulate you all for what you do, for taking care of other people, for trying to literally make the world better, for investing your time, your resources, your will to do things that somehow make other people's life better. And this is what I value about this philanthropy forum. I think this city is full of events, you know. Today we have spring meetings here in Washington, so we have a World Bank, IMF meetings. We have everyday conferences almost on any venue of this city. But there are not so many events in which you gather people that is willing to put as much effort and resources as you can to precisely contribute to the life of others. So thank you again, and I feel very, very humble, very honored to be here with you. Now, let me talk about Colombia. I feel very happy to know that I'm not the only Colombian in the room. You know, I learned some nights ago that when this event was going to be launched, that several Colombian fellows were going to be part of this. I have a special regard for Alejandro Eder, who maybe some of you met already, and there are several others in the room. I mention Alejandro because Alejandro was a real player. He was a member of the negotiating team, and he was the head of the agency that reintegrated members of the different criminal organizations that have been disarmed and demobilized in Colombia. So I'm appointing him just because you have the great opportunity that when I leave, he will have the real questions to respond. But as he is here, several other Colombians that are doing a lot of efforts, a lot of projects in the country for a long time are here with you and are ready to engage, and I understand are trying to connect with all of you for the same purpose. The story of Colombia is a beautiful story. And it's a story of hope. And it's a story that lets you to believe that sometimes impossible things can be done. That sometimes challenges that apparently are impossible to overcome can be confronted, can be tackled. Colombia was the most violent country in the world, according to many experts, by the end of the 90s. We have the two most violent cities in the planet, Medellin and Cali. We were really losing the control of the state in parts of the territory. In the southeast part of the country, southwest, we have a lot of presence of guerrillas from the FARC and ELN. Most of these guerrillas were Marxist guerrillas from the era of Cold War that, as opposed to all other guerrillas, when the Cold War ended, they got stronger because of drug trafficking. There are very few guerrillas in the history of the world that, instead of getting funds from the outside, were funding even NGOs in different countries of the world. How rich they were, precisely because of kidnapping, of this business of drug trafficking, among many other criminal activities, including extortion to Colombians. In the north, we have a counter-reaction to that. So we have the illegal paramilitary groups precisely confronting these guerrillas, but trying to take control, using corruption, doing the worst kind of human rights violations, and funding themselves as well with drug trafficking. So really, the country was in the middle of a very complicated situation. I always like to remind, especially those of you who are American citizens, that you must feel proud of your country. We like your country in Colombia. We are thankful to the United States of America for different reasons, including national strategic interest. The United States came to the support of Colombia. And with Colombian authorities, we crafted a program that we called Plan Colombia. Plan Colombia is far from being a perfect policy. Plan Colombia is far from being without mistakes. But the implementation of Plan Colombia, there's no doubt, contribute to the transformation of Colombia in a way that has not been seen in many other policies. The plan, in essence, allow us to enhance our capabilities on security, on development, and on justice. It was not just a security campaign. It was a multi-layer campaign that, more important than all, instead of replacing Colombian institutions, was crafted to enable Colombian institutions. It allowed Colombian institutions to learn, to get stronger, to get the capabilities that were required to precisely start this process of taking back our own country for our own citizens, of defeating crime and violence, and to start a process of making the presence of the state an opportunity for development for the rest of the country. And that's how it happened. Plan Colombia paved the way to end the conflict. Plan Colombia has paved the way to get to peace. After 15, 20 years, Colombians did their part. And of course, I'm the ambassador of Colombia, so you have to discount me by definition. You should not believe everything I said, you know, because anyway, I am not only very proud of doing this, of speaking about my beloved country, but also because You know, I tell this story with a lot of passion, but Colombians were great. What has happened in Colombia is not the story of one Colombian, of a national hero of this or that color. It's the story of Colombians. In the middle of the struggle, we were able to keep democracy. In the middle of the struggle, Colombians were the one who chose that wanted leaders to confront this situation. With democracy and with institutions, we constrain ourselves of winning on different ways. We constrain ourselves and actually punish misbehavior. And we try to create a set of values, rule of law, and respect for the highest values. The use of force, I have to tell you, the more that I reflect on my time, the decisions I made and participate with, I always come back to the idea that we did it with a lot of conviction under the law precisely to achieve higher ends. The use of force has limited consequences. But if the use of force can create the opportunity for peace, development, and actually better life and prosperity for a country, is what you have to do, is what it makes sense to do. And I said this because that comes from my own part, but somehow that was the way we tried every effort. We knew from the beginning of this campaign that it started after a failed peace process with the FARC, a very frustrating peace process with the FARC by the end of the 90s. We knew that it was necessary to change the balance of power, and by changing the balance of power, creating the conditions for a final political settlement. So that's what President Santos got to. That's what he saw. We were at a point in which we degrade the FARC and any other criminal organization at the time, mainly to 30% of what they originally were. We degrade their leadership, we degrade their manpower, we degrade their capabilities, we degrade their funding in a way that conditions for a peace agreement were set. And once the peace process started, there were certain elements that were considered as a key conditions. First, and very important, not to change the concept of democracy, market-oriented economy, or freedom. That was very key element. And this is a thing we need to endure, because that's how we know we have been able to create opportunities, reduction of poverty, reduction of inequality, and prosperity to our own people. That's how investors have come to the country. That's how the economy has been growing. And by providing security, that's how Colombians have found a better life in the past decade, decade and a half. The second element we saw was not to negotiate with the other side the structure or the future of our armed forces. And the reason was simple. We didn't want to do what happened in other peace processes, because we understand that making peace is beyond having an agreement. It's the implementation of that agreement what matters. It's securing peace what is critical. It's protecting the people of the country. So we needed to keep the capabilities and, of course, evolve onto those for the new challenges that we were going to confront. And, of course, was crafted a logic of a transitional justice system. Transitional justice is very difficult to understand under ordinary conditions. You will know that. I'm just looking to you. And because what you want as a citizen is to be those who offend others, those who commit crime, to be punished. That's what you want in a regular society. If you see someone outside here killing other people, that person might have any justification, but you are expecting to see some kind of punishment for crossing lines. Well, transitional justice is a model to pursue that goal but with the constraints and limitations of a political objective, which is peace. And to achieve peace, you need to grant, of course, hope for the will of disarmament, hope for the will of demobilization, and expect a reintegration. But on the other side, for those hopes to materialize, you need to offer truth, but you cannot offer, you know, many, many years in jail in exchange, just because you will not get the objective of disarmament and demobilization, and you will have to go after them. And precisely somehow, that's where you want to stop, that's where you want to end. But the transitional justice model creates the opportunity for truth, the opportunity for social punishment, if you want, for claiming who did what, at the same time to establish certain level of responsibility of whomever made or did crime, and finally, recognition of those misbehaviors in a way that society can accept, that society can somehow look for reconciliation. That's the way this has been crafted. The better it works, the most feasible that peace will be to the future. So that's, in essence, how this happened. What is Colombia today? Colombia, I describe it as the most violent country in the hemisphere of the world some decade and a half ago. Today, we have the lowest crime rates in 37, 38 years. The economy has been overperforming other peer economies in the region and in the emerging markets when you average the past decade. The country has been attracting investment. We became one of the most attractive investment, foreign direct investment countries in per capita terms in the region, in the world. Colombia has attracted 5 times more tourists than we used to have a decade ago, from 1 million to almost 5 million people coming to the country. The potential is immense on this front. We really hope for, you know, I will set my own goal, 30 million people in the next 5 years. That's a little bit of an amber we should be looking after this major change the country's having and the wonders we have. The country also has been able to reduce poverty by half in just one decade, to create jobs in a sustained way for more than 5 years. And of course, that has created a positive dynamic. Are we out of challenges? Let me tell you, no. We have big, huge challenges. The country needs to, first of all, integrate those areas that are in far lands of the country in a way that people in those areas can connect to the country, can have opportunities, and we can create competition to criminal illegal economies. Because still those are there. Might be the inheritors of the FARC or other gangs or other people that will take care of drug trafficking, illegal mining, human trafficking, extortion, and other crimes. So we will need to take advantage of the time to precisely connect these communities to the country by allowing them to have alternative development, alternative economy, an alternative future, if you want, a legal future. That's very important. But at the same time, we will need to be strong enough to confront those who dare to continue to do violence. We cannot be doubtful about it. We have to be determined about it. We will also need to keep attracting investment. At the end, it's jobs and it's training to people, somehow education, no doubt, while what's going to give the next generation of potential people that was expected to be recruited in criminal organizations a future. We need these people to have a connection to the world, an opportunity to have a job, an opportunity to have an income, and by having an income, having freedom. And by having freedom, allowing them to choose for their kids better education, better future. This is the challenge we have right now. How to do that? How to do it effectively? And it's not a minor challenge. This is why we keep thinking that as we value so much Plan Colombia, we have crafted a new program that we call Peace Colombia. And that Peace Colombia is an effort joined by Colombia, by international donors. No doubt, we expect the United States as a strategic partner of Colombia to be engaged with us on this effort of bringing development, keeping security, and somehow strengthening the justice system in a way that this peace becomes sustainable. It's not only good for Colombia and Colombians, no doubt, that's the first goal. But if it is good for Colombia, it will be good for the region. But it will be good for the values of democracy, freedom, market-oriented economy, and somehow a proven model to different failures, not only in the region, but somehow in the world. So it not only has the benefit of giving an option to 50 million people in Colombia, the third largest country in Latin America, the second largest Spanish speaking in the world, to a country that is 3.5 times the size of Germany, or Texas, California, Vermont, New Hampshire, and other states together, so it's quite a big country. It's not only that, it's also giving a geopolitical success to the policy of the United States and to the policy of the countries and democracies of the world. I think it's important to tell, I have to stop, I know. I will stop in a second. Well, more than a second now. I think it's important to tell that as we have been successful, mainly with taxpayers from Colombia, let me remind you that I spoke highly about the US support, but let me tell you, who paid for the bill in Colombia? 95% of the bill has been paid by Colombian taxpayers. By the way, last December, there was approved a tax reform in Colombia. The additional revenues of this tax reform are planned to be funding these kind of programs that I described, precisely to make peace sustainable. So what we expect from the United States is what we got during Plan Colombia, a push, enablers, support, friendship, the opportunity, and somehow co-responsibility, because unfortunately the drug business is not a thing that happens in Colombia. It's a thing that, you know, gets out of Colombia, crosses Central America, Mexico, comes to the streets of the United States, harms people everywhere, but then the cash flow comes from here in terms of money and weapons. So there's a cycle that we need to cooperate to precisely somehow disrupt. And more important than all, using different kind of policies and approaches, there's no a single one, expecting our people, our communities in Colombia, in Central America, in Mexico, in the United States, in Europe, or elsewhere, to have less harm from crime and from criminals. That's a little bit of the logic of all this. So this is why we keep expecting for this logic of support and effort. But again, moving to the idea that our Colombian taxpayers that really need to do what we have been doing, taking care for our own country, for our own future, for our own destiny, but doing this in a peaceful way to the rest of the world and trying to be contributors of peace and stability to the region, hopefully to the world. Let me end my remarks with two comments. First, nothing of this story would be possible in Colombia without the sacrifice of soldiers, police, citizens that got killed because of their decision to confront different types of criminals and different types of organized crime, terrorists, or criminal organizations. That's how we did it. Our soldiers, our police, those people who got kidnapped, those people who, you know, kept the country to the future, deserve all the credit. We have many wounded soldiers in Colombia. And I know I'm here in front of a philanthropy or a group of people, different organizations and efforts. I'm going to be telling you that one of my future endeavors will be to create a foundation to support the education of the special education abroad, education in the best schools of the world, to the orphans of those soldiers and police that were killed doing their part, fighting for Colombia. They deserve that. So what better than education? And what better to keep honoring them to the rest of my days by precisely doing that? Finally, I learned when I came here that after me, there was going to be a musician, that someone was going to sing. And I said, oh, that's totally unfair, is what I thought when I was told that, Jane, you know? Because I said, well, I will anyway do my best, but I know I will be boring at some point, you know, and I will kind of repeat myself, and that's how you do public talk. So, you know, having a beautiful lady after me singing, that's really challenging, you know, and but I better take it the best possible way. She's gonna sing, but better than all. I met her some time ago. She went to a residence in one of the jazz events that we have, and she really make a case. She will sing beautiful, and of course, sorry, but she's Colombian too, you know? We might get you tired this time. Thank you so much.
Thank you. profunda como el agua. Déjame amarte. Nativa tu mirada que lo dice todo. Profunda como el agua. Déjame amarte, déjame déjame amarte, déjame. Thank you so much. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Naty Hernandez from Colombia. And I wonder what the world would be without compassion, without us helping each other, and seeing the challenge that laid ahead of us makes me feel anxious and helpless. But then I see people like you committing to make a positive change. It is a special occasion for me to share this moment with all of you. And I am grateful for the thousands of causes around the world which became reality for the compassions of those who share what they have. It's because of such a generosity that me and my sister could have an education in Colombia. And I am able to study in one of the most prestigious music colleges in the world because someone I haven't even met paid for my tuition. Music is a gift, and it's a gift that I really want to share. I'm committed to share. I hope my songs encourage others to trust themselves, to be authentic, to make them fearless in order to pursue their dreams. For it is okay to cry and be afraid, as we recognize that the first step in finding our own authenticity is remember that we are perfect in the way we are. And thus we share, thank you so much. This next song is Manos de Agua, and I want to dedicate it to all of you.
Estoy hecha de nostalgia y traigo a mi pasado cerquita el corazón. Por tus ojos, esos que lloré tanto, cogeré la luna para arropar tu cuerpo. Pasa despacito el aire por tus fosas, siento que te hacen reír. Camina sobre el agua y el cielo, tu cabeza con nubes. Ocultas tu mirada y todo lo que sientes, como si el mundo te fuera a aplastar. Tu reflejo se ve tan oscuro, tu cabeza con nubes. No más rompes el pasado a la mitad y echa sus cenizas a nadar en el río. Tomo tus manos, manos de agua, y el frío de la luna me hace tiritar. Ocultas tu mirada y todo lo que sientes, como si el mundo te fuera a aplastar. Tu reflejo se ve tan oscuro, tu cabeza con nubes. No rompe ese pasado a la mitad y echa sus cenizas a nadar en el río. Tomo tus manos, pero son de agua y el frío de la luna me hace tiritar. No más rompe ese pasado a la mitad y echa sus cenizas a nadar en el río. Tomo tus manos, manos de agua y el frío de la luna me hace tiritar. Estoy hecha de nostalgia.